Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter, Jr. This program is designed for English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases especially written for people learning English.
Today, Brian Lynn has a report on a rise in the development of unmanned military vehicles in Ukraine. Anna Mateo and Andrew Smith present this week's Health and Lifestyle Report. We close the show with the lesson of the day. But first,
many new Ukrainian businesses are reportedly developing unmanned military vehicles for the country's war against Russia. The operations often happen in empty warehouses or secret underground factories, the Associated Press, AP, reports. The weaponized vehicles reportedly aim to ease shortages of soldiers and equipment. Workers at laboratories in hundreds of workshops are using technology tools to build robot fighters to battle Russian forces, the AP said. The AP reported that an estimated 250 new defense companies are currently involved in the production of war vehicles across Ukraine. The news agency noted that such operations can look similar to rural car repair shops. Andriy Denisenko heads one of the new companies, or startups. He told the AP his employees can put together an unmanned ground vehicle called the Odyssey in just 4 days. The vehicle has a selling price of $35,000, which is about 10% less than an imported model. Denisenko asked the AP not to publish details about his business to protect the operation and the people working there. The work area is divided into small rooms for welding and bodywork. Workers produce the main structure, paint the vehicles green, and then fit them with basic electronics, power systems, and cameras and sensors. Ukraine's military is considering several different models of new unmanned air, ground, and sea vehicles produced by the startups. A fourth branch of Ukraine's military, the Unmanned Systems Forces, joined the Army, Navy, and Air Force in May. Engineers get production ideas from stories in defense magazines or online videos to produce less costly models. Weapons or smart elements can be added later. We are fighting a huge country, and they don't have any resource limits, said Denisenko. We understand that we cannot spend a lot of human lives. War is mathematics. Reporters from the AP watched the car-sized Odyssey vehicle spin and kick up dust as it rolled through a field of corn during a demonstration in the north of the country last month. The 800-kilogram test model, or prototype, looks like a small tank. Developers of the vehicle say it can travel up to 30 kilometers on one battery charge. The prototype acts as a rescue and supply vehicle, but could be changed to carry a remotely operated heavy machine gun or to clear landmines. A Ukrainian government fundraising website for the unmanned systems forces states that teams of robots will become logistics devices, tow trucks, mine layers, and deminers, as well as self-destructive robots. The first robots are already proving their effectiveness on the battlefield, the statement adds. Mykhailo Fedorov is Ukraine's Deputy Prime Minister for Digital Transformation. He is urging citizens to take free online courses and build military drones at home. Fedorov has called on Ukrainians to make 1 million drone flying machines per year. There will be more of them soon, the Unmanned Systems Forces website said. Many more. Denisenko's company is working on other projects as well. One is a motorized exoskeleton designed to increase a soldier's strength. Another carrier vehicle would be able to transport a soldier's equipment and even help him move uphill. We will do everything to make unmanned technologies develop even faster. Russia's murderers use their soldiers as cannon fodder while we lose our best people, Fedorov wrote in a message published online. Human Rights Watch and other international rights groups are calling for a ban on weapons that do not involve human decision-making. This concern has been shared by others, including the UN General Assembly, American businessman Elon Musk, and the founders of the Google-owned, London-based startup DeepMind. I'm Brian Lynn.
People who grow their own food are familiar with planting tomatoes, peppers, squash, herbs, berries, and other common fruits and vegetables. However, they may not think of growing plants for drinks. Gardening expert Jessica Damiano recently wrote about plants you can grow to make tea. Damiano, who writes for the Associated Press, says that growing your own tea plants in the garden can provide enough leaves and flower buds to keep your teapot filled year-round. And the plant to grow, she says, is Camellia sinensis, var sinensis, also known as the tea plant. These evergreen plants are easy to grow in any amount of sunlight, from deep shade to full sun. However, ideal growing conditions are part sun to light shade. They require well-draining soil with a slightly acidic pH. Young plants will take about 2 years to produce enough leaves for tea. In 5 years, one plant should provide enough for an average tea drinker. If you need more tea, Damiano says to plant more Camellia sinensis. Camellia sinensis is called the tea plant because white, green, black, and oolong teas all come from this plant. Their differences come from harvesting practices and after-harvest treatments. For white tea, Pick the flower buds before they fully open. Heat the buds in a pan over low heat, moving them often for about 10 minutes. Cool them and store in an airtight container. For green, black, and oolong tea, pick 2 or 3 of the youngest leaves from each stem, along with the leaf bud from each stem tip. Do this every 10 to 12 days as new growth develops.
Preparing green, oolong, or black tea all have different processes. For making green tea, briefly steam leaves over boiling water. Then put the leaves on a clean towel and let them sit for 5 minutes. Roll up the leaves in the towel gently to remove extra water. Remove the leaves from the towel, separate them, and place them on a baking sheet. Heat in an oven or toaster oven set to 148 degrees Celsius or 300 degrees Fahrenheit for 10 to 15 minutes or until the leaves are completely dry. Brew immediately or cool and keep them in an airtight container for future use. For making oolong tea, put the leaves in one layer on a baking tray. Put the tray in a sunny outdoor spot to let the leaves wilt. After 30 to 60 minutes, move the tray into the shade and move the leaves every hour for 8 to 10 hours. Next, place the leaves in a wide pan and cook them over low heat for 15 minutes, moving gently as needed to prevent burning. Let the leaves cool and roll each leaf individually to keep its oils and flavors. They should be completely dry before storing in an airtight container. To make black tea, place leaves on a baking sheet in the sun for 10 to 12 hours to remove only 50 to 75% of the water. Then, cut the leaves into long pieces and roll into small balls. Place the balls in a warm room between 25 and 26 degrees Celsius, or 78 to 80 degrees Fahrenheit, that is not too dry of a room, until they turn reddish black. Then dry them in an oven at 93 degrees Celsius, or 200 degrees Fahrenheit, for 5 minutes. Lower the heat to 60 degrees Celsius, or 140 degrees Fahrenheit, and continue drying for an additional hour. Cool and store in an airtight container.
Native to China, Camellia sinensis, var sinensis, is cold hardy. That means it can survive in cold weather. However, it may need some protection to survive cold winters. The same is true for another variety of this flower, Camellia sinensis var assamica. Native to India, this kind is more like a tree. You will have to research which kinds of Camellia sinensis can grow in your area. On its website, the International Camellia Society gives you suggestions for how to protect these plants during a cold winter. Mulching. Apply a thick layer of mulch around the base to protect the roots. Covering. Use a cloth to cover the plant during extreme cold. Watering. Water the plant well before the first freeze. Location. Plant your camellia in a sheltered spot, such as near a building, to protect it from cold winds. Pruning. Avoid pruning late in the season. New growth may not survive colder weather. I'm Ana Mateo.
And I'm Andrew Smith.
Andrew Smith is here now to talk more about the Health and Lifestyle Report. Hi, Andrew. Good to have you here.
Of course. It's my pleasure. Thanks for having me on the show today.
I learned a lot from this particular story. For instance, I had no idea all these different kinds of tea came from one plant.
Me neither. From the Camellia sinensis, we get white, black, green, and oolong tea.
So, how does one plant give us such different tasting teas?
Well, it depends on which parts you use, when you pick the parts, and how you prepare the plant after you harvest it.
Can you give us an example?
Sure. So, for white tea, pick the flower buds before they fully open. Then heat the buds in a pan over low heat, moving them often for about 10 minutes.
And how is harvesting white tea different from green, black, and oolong?
For green, black, and oolong tea, pick two or three of the youngest leaves from each stem, along with the leaf bud from each stem tip. You should do this every 10 to 12 days as new growth develops.
And I am guessing the preparation is different too?
Yes. Green, black, and oolong are all prepared differently to get those very different tasting teas.
Okay, Andrew, thanks so much for answering my questions, and thanks to you and Anna for that interesting report.
It was my pleasure.
VOA Learning English has launched a new program for children. It is called Let's Learn English with Anna. The new course aims to teach children American English through asking and answering questions and experiencing fun situations. For more information, visit our website, learningenglish.voanews.com.
Tomorrow, Mario Ritter Jr. brings us a new education report. In this week's report, he looks at efforts by political leaders to pass laws that would ban students from using their cell phones in schools. Studies show that most schools already have policies on student cell phone use, but some teachers say they cannot control students and that a law is necessary. Listen tomorrow to hear more on that subject. For now, we turn to the lesson of the day.
And now it's time for the lesson of the day on the Learning English podcast. My name is Jill Robbins, and I'm joined by Andrew Smith. Hi, Andrew.
Hi, Jill.
Our lesson is based on our video series, Let's Learn English. The series shows Anna Mateo in her work and life in Washington, D.C. Here's Anna introducing herself.
Hello, my name is Anna Mateo.
In Lesson 19 of Level 2 of the series, Anna and Pete are going to the theater to watch a movie. Pete does not like it when people talk or make noise in the theater. So before he and Anna go in the theater, Pete asks Anna if she talks during a movie.
Hi, Pete. Thanks for the movie invitation.
Yeah, sure, Anna.
I love movies. I love the plot. I love the set design. I love the costumes. I love the...
Anna, I take movies very seriously. You're not one of those people who talks during a movie, are you?
No.
Good.
Anna says she doesn't talk during a movie, but Pete probably does not like any sounds or distractions when he watches a movie.
A distraction is something that takes your attention away from something you want to focus on or concentrate on. And the verb form of this word is distract. Jill, can you give an example of a distraction?
That's an easy question. Mobile phones distract people all the time.
Very true. And sometimes they can distract people in a movie theater. So here's another question. If you are in a theater and someone is distracting you by talking or looking at their phone or making noise, how can you politely ask them to stop?
Today's lesson answers that question. In general, to make polite requests, we use the words would or could at the beginning of the question. But there are other ways as well. Andrew, would you please play the next part of Lesson 19 for our listeners? That way they can hear more examples of polite ways to ask questions.
Sure. Here's Anna and Pete in the movie theater. Listen for the ways Pete asks Anna to stop doing certain things.
Well, look, the previews are starting. I love to see what movies are coming out. Oh, this one looks good.
Anna, the previews are part of the movie experience. So would you mind not talking?
Oh, sure.
Anna, I was wondering, are you almost finished with that?
No, there's still a lot of milkshake at the bottom.
Anna, would you mind not drinking so loudly?
I'll try, but it's really thick.
Anna, what are you doing?
Pete is getting a little upset with Anna, and he does not try to make his last question polite. Instead, it is very direct.
Anna, what are you doing?
But his other questions were more polite. Listen to them again and see if you can hear the phrases he uses to make them sound polite.
So would you mind not talking? I was wondering, are you almost finished with that? Anna, would you mind not drinking so loudly?
We often use the phrase, would you mind or do you mind, to make questions more polite.
When we say, would you mind, the verb must take the ing form. Jill, would you mind giving our listeners another example of polite requests?
Sure, no problem. We can also use the expression, I was wondering, like Pete did.
I was wondering, are you almost finished with that?
Now let's hear more of Lesson 19. Listen for the phrase, would you mind, plus the ing form of the verb.
Anna, would you mind opening that a little bit more quietly?
I'll try.
Anna, just give it to me. Shh, it's not mine. I'm opening it for her.
Shh.
Here. Now, would you mind being more quiet? Excuse me. Would you mind turning down your phone light?
Oh, sorry. I forgot to turn my phone off. Oh no, I dropped it. Where is it?
Oh. Anna, can you please turn your phone off?
Excuse me, would you mind lending me your phone light for a minute?
No, I'll get it.
People in the theater are now asking Pete to be quiet.
And that's what we call an ironic situation. Because Pete is a person who really wants it to be quiet when he watches movies.
In addition to the word ironic, we have another expression for this. We can say the tables have turned on Pete. That means the thing you want or the thing you are fighting against affects you negatively and you don't get what you want. We just heard four more examples of questions with the expression, would you mind? Here they are again.
Anna, would you mind opening that a little bit more quietly? Now, would you mind being more quiet? Excuse me, would you mind turning down your phone light?
Excuse me, would you mind lending me your phone light for a minute?
Finally, Pete gets upset and loudly tells everyone in the theater that he is not a person who makes noise in a movie theater. But he says it so loudly that a security guard politely asks Pete to leave.
Excuse me, sir. You can't yell in a movie theater. Would you mind coming with me?
You're kicking me out? Me? But I'm always the quiet one in the movie.
Poor Pete. He's had a really bad day at the movies. But we hope you've had a good time with the lesson of the day on our podcast. To review, here are some ways we can ask questions politely.
We can begin the question with the words could or would, like this.
Could you please explain some more?
Sure. We can also start the question with the expression, I was wondering.
I was wondering if you could explain even more.
Sure. No problem. We can also use the expression, would you mind? Plus the ing form of the verb.
Would you mind telling our listeners where they can learn more?
Sure. Just visit our website, and you can download a lesson plan for Lesson 19. It explains more about polite questions.
And remember that you can find more from VOA Learning English on Facebook, YouTube, and Instagram. And listeners, if you don't mind, could you please share the lesson of the day with your friends and family? Thanks.
And thanks for listening. I'm Andrew Smith.
And I'm Jill Robbins.
That's our program for today. Join us again tomorrow to keep learning English through stories from around the world. I'm Ashley Thompson.
And I'm Mario Ritter Jr.